Hi there, how y'all doing? So, we're out here in the garage. I'm just kind of hanging out. About to get some stuff ready to go fishing tomorrow. Gonna do some cold water bass fishing. But winter is definitely set in. We did not have a fall at all. We literally had like a day of fall, and then it just got really, really cold. The high today is, let's see here, a solid 49 degrees. Tomorrow's high, let's see, is gonna be a solid 61. So tomorrow's gonna be a little bit warmer. A lot of it has to do with how much sun we're gonna have tomorrow. But then going on, looking into the week, our lowest day next week is we're gonna have a high of 32 and a low of 18. So like I said, winter has set in quickly in the Tennessee Valley, and winter fishing will be, you know, not far behind it. And really, the thing about living in the South and what's cool about living here is that we don't really ever have to worry about ice. I mean, we'll have a freak occasion where it'll get really cold outside and some of our lakes will ice over. But when I say they ice over, I mean, it's not ice thick enough to walk on. It'll be like the backs of the pockets and stuff like that. But for the most part, you know, 45 degrees is about as cold as our water is going to get. So that lends itself to a couple of different ways that we can fish where we don't have to slow down and like drag a jig or fish a blade bait or do stuff like that. And I can kind of avoid that and do the stuff I like to do the best, which is crank, jerk bait, and just keep moving down the bank. So that's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to get up in the boat. I'm going to pull out a few rods, rig up a few things, get it ready for tomorrow, and we're going to talk about the baits that I think you guys need for winter bass fishing so that you don't have to slow down, you don't have to drag a jig, and you can keep moving, keep yourself warm, and catch a bunch of big bass. So hopefully you guys will enjoy today's episode. Gosh, it's cold out here today. I don't like it. I need more clothes on, but the wind's blowing. It's just getting so cold so quick. Like it is so winter, and I don't like it. But I do like it all at the same time because it means that it is time to pick up crankbaits. It's time to pick up jerkbaits. It's time to start power fishing, get those reaction bites. And that's what I like to do as far as winter bass fishing. I mean, I'm the kind of guy that I want to cover as much water as I possibly can and try to get those reaction bites. I definitely take a page out of the playbook of Kevin Van Dam when it comes to winter fishing. I don't like to slow down. I don't like to drag something. I want to cover water and I want to get those reaction bites. Now, if it's one of those deals where I feel like I need to slow down to get those bites, then I definitely will. But for the most part, like I say, I want to be power fishing. So that's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about the baits that you guys need so that you don't have to slow down. You can cover a ton of water and still fish very effectively and still get a ton of big bites. And really, these are the baits that I have tied on not only in the fall, but all throughout the winter into the spring. And it's baits that I get a ton of bites on. Now, what you'll notice is early winter fishing, kind of where we're at right now, November, December, I key in on a lot of shad patterns. And then once we get into late December, January, February, that's when I start to pick up the crawfish patterns. The reason for that is my fish really dictate that kind of decision-making process. My fish start to key in on less bait fish and they start to key in on more crawfish the later and later we get into winter. And I think a lot that has to do with just metabolism slowing down. The colder it gets, the slower those fish move and the less work they want to have to put out to actually get the reward of a meal. And so they start keying in on those crawfish colors a lot more. And then two, you have to get them to react a little bit more. So fishing those brighter colors gets those fish to react a little bit better. So let's start with the first bait, and that is going to be the old square bill. I love fishing a square bill, especially early winter. Start catching those fish that are transitioning, you know, up to eat a lot of bait fish, get ready for that cold weather, but then they start to kind of hang out in those flat areas. And that's really where I think that this bait, as well as the second bait I'll talk about here in just a minute, are the most effective, is those flat areas, those, you know, big areas where you have to cover a ton of water. Because what will happen is bait fish will move up onto those flat areas to sun themselves and be in that warm sun, and then the bass just ultimately follow, not only for that sun just like the bait fish want, but for the food that the bait fish provide. And so something like 1.5 square bill is an awesome tool to go and hit those areas and fish them very effectively. As you notice, this is a shad pattern. Shad patterns in early winter are what I key in on because those fish are keying in on those shad patterns. Now, once I feel like those fish have made that transition to kind of that late winter pattern, they've moved back out on those main lake banks, they're starting to use that dark slate and those, you know, more rocky style banks in that late winter, that's when I want to pick up some kind of crawl pattern. And I kind of play with my patterns. I've got a bunch of different crawl patterns. As you guys can see, I have the more, how that hook is so sharp. I've got the more methylated, crazy looking colors like the chili crawl, and then I got some more, you know, obviously very bright, but not as bright as the methylated, but something like this one. This is, I think, red Texas crawl or something like that. I'll have it linked down below so you guys can check it out. But pick up some kind of crawl pattern, and you know, you're still focusing on that really shallow water, that 2 to 5 foot range, but you're focusing on a different set of fish. You're focusing on a set of fish that have moved away from those flat areas. They're starting to use those main lake banks so that they can transition up and down really easily, and they're just starting to eat on bait fish a lot more. And that's something you'll notice too. Around me, I fish a lot of TVA lakes, Tennessee Valley Authority lakes, and those lakes have drawdowns. And to me, it is a lot easier for a fish to move vertically instead of horizontally. And so, you know, those fish that are residential fish that live on a main lake bank or transition to a flat to eat and then transition back out to a main lake bank, it's a lot easier for them to move up and down as to move like around and have to travel a long distance. And so what I've noticed is you can go to the same place that you were fishing 10 foot, you know, higher in the water when the water was up, and just go to the same areas with something like this 1.5 and catch those fish, because they will still be in those areas. They'll just move down with that water and they'll start eating on different things like crawfish and stuff like that. But definitely the 1.5. All my cranking setups, I'm gonna go through them as we go. My small body cranking setup and my square bill setup are almost identical. 7 foot medium loose. This is a Hack Attack rod, but it's a 7 foot medium loose cranking rod. It's a moderate action, which is super important. That parabolic bend really allows you to drive those treble hooks in. I've got it paired up with a 6-8 gear ratio reel. This is a loose LFS, and then some 12 pound fluorocarbon. This actually happens to be Strike King fluorocarbon. I've been testing it out. They sent me some over before it releases out to the public, and I've been digging it so far. But just a good 7 foot modern action rod. You can really fish any of the crankbaits I'm going to talk about today and do really, really well with it. The next one is going to be for those more transitional fish, those more migratory fish, those fish that want to get a little bit deeper into the water column, or if you are fishing those same residential fish, but they slip off into a little bit deeper water, and that is going to be some kind of small body crankbait. My two favorites, really over the past couple years, my love for these two in particular have grown, and that is the Spro Rock Crawler and the KVD 3XD, or the Strike King 3XD. And I love both of these baits. They are baits that get a ton of bites. Don't worry, I'm not going to fail to mention the Bandit 300, Bandit 200, both excellent baits. But what I've noticed is there's just a lot more efficiency in these two baits, especially the Spro Rock Crawler. It has a weight transfer system in it. It's really easy to cast. You can make very precision casts, and it dives really, really hard. But optimally, these are fishing that kind of 8 to 10 foot range of water. And like I said, I use these where when I feel like the fish have moved just a little bit deeper, especially post cold front. What you'll notice is bass, when those cold fronts move through, during the cold front, they're eating and they're gorging themselves. And then post cold front, they'll move just a little bit deeper and they'll want to sit in those areas and kind of just hang out and relax while that post cold front kind of weather is going through. And that's where you've got to pick up these a little bit deeper diving crankbaits, just to get it down there to those fish, because for the most part, you can still get them to react. You're just going to have to get a crankbait that'll actually get down there to where they're at. And when I say deeper water, I'm talking about that 8 to 10 foot range. You know, a bass will go from living in 2 to 4 foot to living in, you know, 6 to 8 foot, and just want to transition just a little bit deeper after a cold front. And that is where these baits are the most optimal. But as you guys can see, crawl patterns on these as well, a lot of the same reasons. We're going to talk about a bait here in just a minute that kind of hits the same depth range, but it's totally different than it's in a shad pattern. But definitely the crawl patterns seem to be the most successful for me. I think a lot of it has to do with when those fish do transition to that little bit deeper water, like I said, they get a little more lazy, a little more lethargic, and having some kind of crawl pattern that is going to imitate the crawfish that they're eating and make them react to that color pattern is what you're going to need to get a reaction by it. And like I said, I got a different setup for these crankbaits just because of some attributes that this rod has that the other one doesn't. And I made a video about why I have four cranking rods that I'll link up above and down below so you guys can check it out. But I'm throwing these on a 7-foot David Fritz Lose cranking rod, custom pro reel, 12-pound test rod. This rod is just a little bit softer than that 1.5 rod, and I like that for these crankbaits because on your medium diving crankbaits, I'm fishing a number 6 size hook. A little bit lighter wire, a little bit smaller, so I think that softer action of that rod really helps to keep those hooks pinned, where with my 1.5s, I'm throwing a number 4 size hook, so I got a little more bulk there. I don't have to worry about it as much, and I can, you know, horse them just a little bit more per se. And then two, with that 1.5, sometimes you're throwing up in a little bit heavier cover, and so you want to be able to get those fish out of there. But those Spro rock crawlers, those 8 to 10 foot divers, really, really awesome for when the 1.5 bite has died down and you feel like those fish have transitioned just a little bit deeper, usually post front and usually later on in the winter. Those fish will want to be in just a tad bit deeper water because it's a little more stable overall. And so you can pick up 3XD Spro rock crawler Bandit 300 and get a ton of bites that way. Now, one bait that kind of falls into this category of mid-range diving crankbait but is definitely for late winter fishing is going to be the KVD flatside crankbait. A flat-sided crankbait is going to give you a totally different look and feel in the water than something like a 3XD is going to. That flat side on that crankbait is going to push a ton of water. It's going to have a very wide wobble, and it's very akin to the kind of wobble that you're going to get out of the 1.5. So that being said, if you feel like they're eating the 1.5 really, really well, but then they transition a little bit deeper and they don't want to eat that 3XD, but they're still in that depth range, pick up something like this KVD flat side. It's still going to get down to that 8 to 10 foot range, but it's going to have that wide exaggerated wobble like the square bill is going to, and you can get some reaction bites. You can get some reaction bites out of those fish. And you know, I fish these in shad patterns a whole lot. I mean, you guys can tell this one has been absolutely munched on. It's kind of blown out, but the paint and everything is just absolutely eat off of this bait. I've caught a ton of fish on this bait, and I feel like for some reason, I guess it's the action of this bait or what it is, that the shad patterns do a little bit better. But that being said too, I've had really good days on the crawl patterns as well. But that 1.5 flat side KVD crankbait is absolutely amazing for when you feel like they're in the 3XD range, but they are still munching on that 1.5 square bill style of bait, that kind of action that it puts out in the water. And I'm going to fish these baits on that same rod that I'm going to fish my 3XDs and stuff on. So awesome little bait. Definitely sneaky little bait that I need not fail to mention because I think it'll help you guys out. Now the next crankbait is the lipless, and this is a bait late winter for sure. Now it's good all throughout the fall, all throughout the winter, but I've had the most success on it late winter, and really that February to March transition, really where we start to transition into that early spring bite. I call it the late winter bite because March and February and March are really two of the coldest months that we have. But I have had some absolutely ridiculous days on the lipless crankbait. And this bait for me is when those fish start to transition back up. They start to use those flats again. That water starts to rise up. They want to start to follow that water up, follow those bait fish up, and you can get a tremendous amount of bites on this thing. I'm going to fish a couple of colors. Number one is going to be some kind of shad pattern. If I'm on a clearer lake, if I'm in water that I feel like isn't tremendously muddy, I'm gonna pick up some kind of shad pattern. This is a, I think it's called Tokyo shad or something like that. It's a really good kind of translucent color. I love the natural green colors it has in it, but I wanna pick up some kind of shad pattern if I'm in a little bit clearer water. But for the most part, that late winter fishing, I'm gonna have some kind of crawl and or crawl chartreuse pattern on. This one's Rayburn Red up top. This is one that I've had a tremendous amount of success on. And then this one is called, I think, green tomato or fried tomato or something like this. As you guys can see, it's that crawl, but you still get that flash of chartreuse on it. The reason for that is, I said this just a few seconds ago, is that water starts to rise back up. When you fish in lakes that have a tremendous drawdown, the other side of that is they will eventually fill those lakes back up. And as they fill those lakes back up, they start to get muddier and muddier and muddier. And I've just found that even if the fish are feeding on shad, having some kind of chartreuse or methylate base is what you're gonna need to stand out in the water to get that reaction bite. For the most part, the bass are gonna be feeding off their lateral line when it comes to things like the lipless crankbait. I mean, they're gonna hear that bait coming through the water and they're going to react to it, but they need that flash of that chartreuse to actually be able to react to that bait and slap at it. And I mean, oftentimes you're gonna hook them, you know, in the side of the face and the top of the back and the tail, because all they do is just react and slap at it. A lot of them you'll catch in the mouth, I mean, because they'll just catch up to it and eat it. But this, that being said, you will catch a ton of them just slapping at it too. So I think it's very important not only to have that color, but upgrade those treble hooks as well. I did a video about how I buy my treble hooks. I'll make sure and link it as well. But I love to upgrade those treble hooks. I usually go a 2X strong on here, like a short shank EWG. Sometimes I'll go a round bend. It just depends on how well the fish are eating it. I feel like when they slap at it more, I want the round bend, but when they're eating it well, I want that EWG, because when you stick them with that EWG, they are not coming off. But definitely a lipless crankbait, awesome tool. It is a tool that I've caught a ton of fish on. I mean, you guys can probably see this mug. He's got some battle scars on him for sure, all ate up. This is one that I've caught a ton of fish on. Me and Caleb Bell, good friend of mine, had about a 50 fish day using liplesses and 1.5s in that late winter. I think it was the first day of March, to be honest. So it was the last week of February, first day of March, and we absolutely crushed them on the lipless and the 1.5, because we found a lot of those fish that they brought the lake up very quickly. Those fish transitioned following the bait, following the crawfish. They transitioned up onto a flat and we were able to absolutely annihilate them. And I'll link videos down below, up above. I'll link a whole playlist so you guys can go check it out. I never talk about anything I've not had experience doing, and I can assure you I have hundreds of hours of video evidence that proves that these baits catch fish. Now, my lipless crankbait setup, I'm fishing a 7.5 foot medium heavy rod. The reason for that is I want a little bit extra length on this rod, because when I am fishing these lipless crankbaits, I'm fishing them in fairly shallow water. 2 to 5 foot usually is where I like to fish these baits. And so having a little bit longer rod helps me to keep my rod tip up and keep that bait coming through an area. Especially when I'm fishing around rocks or grass or shell beds, one of the biggest struggles that you'll have is actually getting these baits hung up. But what I've found is if I throw just a little bit longer rod, I'm able to keep that bait up but still keep it near the bottom and get a ton of bites. And I'm actually going to bump up my line on here. I'm going 12 to 15 pound fluorocarbon, just because I feel like sometimes that 15, again, because you're fishing around shell beds and rocks, is going to come through there a lot better, and you don't have to worry about breaking any fish off or anything like that. And then again, 6-8 gear ratio reel. For the most part, across the board, it's 6-8 gear ratio reel with my cranking rods, 10 to 12 pound test, sometimes 15 if I feel like I need it. But they are all glass cranking rods. This is a David Fritz cranking rod. And then I have the David Fritz and the Hack Attack rod over here as well. But I don't care what brand you use, guys. You can use whatever you want to, but I would definitely suggest getting a good glass cranking rod, a moderate action rod. You can get away with fishing all these baits on a 7 foot medium moderate action rod. And do really, really well. But that cranking rod is very important so that you don't jerk those hooks out of those fish's face. And then that is it. Those are the baits that I have tied on all winter long. I love to crank, guys. I mean, it is something that I do all winter long. I love it. It is just a way for me to catch a ton of fish, a ton of big fish, and effectively fish an area and feel like that I'm covering as much water as I possibly can, but still getting the biggest bites that I possibly can. But, as always, guys, thank you for watching. Any questions or comments, go leave them in the comment section down below. If you're new to my channel, make sure to hit that like, subscribe, and notification bell. Let you guys know when I put out all my videos. Also, go down in the description. I have links to my partners, like Lou, Strike King. You guys can go check out all their stuff. Also, Monster Bass, AFCO, all that will be linked down below. But as always, you guys are sweet. Thank you for watching.